Good morning, Presbyterians.
Now, first, Steve, sing to the Lord. Let them do that. Let us rise and praise the Lord. No matter what we're going through here on earth, it's not always pleasant, it's not always good, but we know that bottom line is our God reigns. So the first one is our God reigns.
Oh,
The proof of God's amazing love is this. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Because we have faith in him, we dare to approach God with confidence. In faith and penitence, let us silently confess our sin before God. Believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ you are forgiven. Thanks be to God. You may be seated.
Thank you. even got what. And then maybe he started coming to Sunday school, maybe he started doing things and learning. So he saw a little glimpse of God. So what would you think somebody who saw this airplane? Do you think he knew God a little bit better?
I can't see it well.
Here, pass it down. Here, let me pull it to you. So you think that's a little bit bigger? Maybe he went, what happened? The storm goes. The guy, I have not a lot. You all can take that one and play with it. But apparently the father said, look at that airplane in the sky. It was a little teeny. And then where did he take him? Remember? Where did he take
him? To the airport.
And what did he say?
He said,
see how big the plane is now?
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
You get to turn and listen to the Word of God this morning. One of the greatest privileges and blessings, yes, that we've been given. One that we may be very familiar with, but maybe we also take for granted. So let us prepare our hearts to hear from God's Word. If you have your Bibles, you're more than welcome to turn with me. We'll begin in the Gospel of John. Hear the word of the Lord. Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands, and put my finger where the nails were, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand. Put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed."
Amen.
And then we hear from Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. If you haven't had a chance this Easter season, one of the most precious and important chapters on the resurrection. 1 Corinthians 15, beginning in verse 17, hear the word of the Lord. "And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. Then those who have fallen asleep in Christ are lost. If only for this life we have hope in Christ, we of all people are most to be pitied. But Christ has indeed been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep, picking up in verse 51. Listen, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed. In a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. For the perishable must clothe itself with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality. And when the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality, then the saying that is written will come true. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, He gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Therefore, my dear brothers, sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. The word of the Lord. Please pray with me. Lord, as we've gathered in this place, we pray that by the power of your Spirit, you may focus our hearts and minds to be those who hear and receive and respond, to be in awe of the resurrection, to be those who embrace it, and those who are empowered to live in it. That you might be glorified in your kingdom further. We pray this in the name of our risen Lord Jesus. Amen. You know, as we've kind of gotten used to, Steve gives us the trivia whenever he's up here for our liturgist in the morning. And sometimes he'll share with us firsts. The first time this happened, or on this day. And we experience, when we experience something for the first time, it's memorable. Right? First kiss, first job, first car, first home. Firsts are notable. Magellan was the first to circumvent the globe. Charles Lindbergh, first to fly solo across the Atlantic Ocean. Babe Ruth, first to baseball player to hit 700 home runs. There's something remarkably satisfying about being first. There's always, I also like the passage where John in the gospel talks about how he got to the tomb first without saying his name. I love that. That one I can mess with all day. But today we continue to celebrate the most significant first in human history. Yes, technically there were others who had been raised from the dead according to the scriptures, but Jesus was the first one to rise from the grave to never die again. And that is incredibly significant to us this morning. This is what Paul really means in 1 Corinthians when he calls Jesus the first fruits of the resurrection. He's saying that we're the ones who get to follow when the first harvest comes. We will be like him. But I don't want to get ahead of myself. There were lots of firsts on that Sunday morning. And remember, folks, why we worship on Sunday? Because Jesus was raised on Sunday. The two Marys were probably the first to the tomb that day, if you don't count the guards that collapsed in fear. And at the start, these two women, they didn't come believing. They didn't come there believing, but hurting. They had not come with a sense of anticipation, but with brokenness and with grief. And yet, it was still an act of devotion. They had come to finish the burial process they weren't able to complete before the Sabbath started Friday evening. And I think there is a message there, a veiled message there, that we don't want to miss. That when we meet Jesus, he's still the crucified one. Does that surprise you? That's important. Resurrection is not the denial of crucifixion. Resurrection takes crucifixion and casts it in a new light. That because of Easter, there is great hope for us, but hope and grief are often bound together. As it says in Psalm 30, weeping may last for the night, but joy comes with the morning. William was hoping we would be doing Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, Yes, Lord. We know that song, and we know that psalm as well. Weeping may last, may linger for the night, but joy comes with the morning. Henri Nouwen, in his book, Life of the Beloved, describes a scene from the funeral mass of President John F. Kennedy. He writes, the priest, richly dressed in splendid liturgical vestments, is lifted up by the people. He towers above the crowd, carrying in his hands a glass chalice. And suddenly the human pyramid collapses and the priest comes tumbling down. His vestments are ripped, the glass chalice falls to the ground and is shattered. And as he's starting to walk through the debris, barefoot, wearing blue jeans and a simple shirt, children's voices are still singing, praise, praise, praise. And suddenly the priest notices the broken chalice. He looks at it for a long time and then haltingly he says, I never realized that broken glass could shine so brightly. And you may have heard the saying, the only man-made thing in heaven are the scarred hands and feet of Jesus. I remember having a theological discussion with a seminary friend when we were in seminary about that. And yet, scriptures are pretty clear, I believe, that we have Jesus who will be known by his scars. That's not just a sentimental thought. The Apostle John shares this from his vision of heaven in Revelation. Then I saw a lamb looking as if it had been slain, sitting on the center of the throne. That's the vision of Easter, that in the morning, as the light streams into the tomb, we see with eyes of faith that the risen one chose to be known by his scars. This is why Paul reserves the topic of resurrection for the end of his letter in Corinthians. He saves the best for last so that it can shine all the more brightly. That in this life, we're going to have conflict. I'm guessing that you are in the midst of conflict right now, or you're just coming out of it, or you're just about to go into it. That we're going to have problems of all kind. That we're going to have despair, and that we're even going to die. And our loved ones as well. Paul doesn't dance around that. Neither did Jesus. But no, as the Lord of the dance, he danced right through it. He held death in his very hands, up close and personal to the very end of the song. But the thing to remember is that as Lord, he did the leading. Let's never forget that. There's a movie called Meet Joe Black, where death comes to life, so to speak. Death is manifested as a human being. And we're going to try and understand what the big deal is all about with death. What's the big deal? So he compels a man who has a fatal heart condition to instruct him in life, to understand why human beings cling to life with every ounce of strength that they have. And in the end, the character that represents death discovers love and joy and realizes the power that life has, but nevertheless returns to being death, a taker rather than a giver of life. When Jesus came into the world, he declared that his mission statement was not about death, but about life. He says it again and again and again in the Gospel of John, I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. I am the resurrection and the life. Everyone who believes in me will live and never die. This is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and the one you have sent. Life, life, life. Amen. In fulfilling his mission, Jesus did the impossible by taking dead people and making them living people. And that's what it continues to do in his church. This is the victory of Calvary. This is the victory of the empty tomb. And of course, thank God those early Christians, they listened to the message. The first ones got to see it. Mary, Peter, John, Thomas, the rest. They were blessed to see and believe. But the ones that Paul wrote to, they listened and believed. And so their lives were a testament to the power of the resurrection. They lived as a people had been given a new beginning, that they had passed from darkness to light, that the world changed because they allowed the risen Christ to shine through them. We take that for granted, I think. There's a widely told story, allegedly, about Robert Louison Stevenson, author of Treasure Island, who suffered from ill health as a child. Well, one night, the nurse found him up out of bed, his nose pressed against the window. "Come here, child. You're going to catch your death of cold." But he wouldn't budge. Instead, he sat mesmerized, watching a lamplighter slowly work his way through the dark night, lighting each street light along his route. And pointing to him, Robert said, "Look, look there! There's a man poking holes in the darkness." This morning, perhaps you need someone to poke holes in the darkness. And that's resurrection. That's Easter resurrection, resurrection of the body, which is at the very core of our faith. Let me share an image of what it means to experience this new life, to become resurrection people. I want you to go back to that window pane, the one that young Robert had his nose pressed against, no doubt smudging it in all of his wonder. Imagine that pane of glass as our heart and our soul, smudged all over with guilt and shame, covered with faults and failures. But then there's that word forgiven. And when we're forgiven, that pane of glass is wiped clean. But don't only think about the cleanliness of it. Imagine how much brighter and clearer everything would be, including the one poking holes in the darkness. Consider how much a difference God's forgiveness makes through Jesus' resurrection for you. We number one, we become the people God created us to be and recreated us to be. Number two, we allow the light of Christ to shine more clearly through us. And finally, number three, we will rise as He is risen. That's the wonder of it all. That's the good news, the great news of this season, of our entire lives, that if anyone is in Christ, they are a new creation. Everything old has passed away. Everything has become new. We are the people of the living hope, of the risen Lord, of the Lord of the dance. We're His people. His people. Maybe you're here this morning, present in body, but any kind of spiritual victory may seem pretty unlikely. John, Peter, Thomas, Mary, they all felt the same way. You're in their shoes. So here's the good news. Death has been swallowed up in victory.
Amen.
Maybe you're here this morning and there's a lot in your life that needs to be wiped away before the sun rises through you. The Apostle Paul started the same place before he was given a new name. And he has something to tell you. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Maybe you're here this morning and you have felt the heavy weight of the cross, and now you long for, you hope against hope for, the freedom of the empty tomb. Hear the good news. He is not in that cold, dark place. He has poked holes in the darkness. Christ is risen. And like Him, we rise. That part we need to remember, especially. 1 Corinthians, Paul goes on. He shows forth the evidence. He gives the testimony. Christ died for our sins. He was buried. He was raised on the third day. He appeared to more than 500, then to Paul. And then, yes, He appears to you and to me. That wherever there is forgiveness, He appears. Wherever there is new creation, He appears. Wherever there is victory over sin's slavery and death's grip, he appears. Not just metaphorically, but truly, resurrection still happens. Let me ask you, how is it happening in your life? Because as I've said, the last 2 weeks, Easter isn't once a year. It's not one day a year. The risen Lord deserves far more worship than that, and the world should feel a lot more impact than that. So I ask, how are you responding to this good news? That death is swallowed up in victory, that like him, we rise. Let me close with a story. Reverend Will Willeman was the dean of the chapel at Duke University, and he tells the story of a student who was hanging around after the service. He hadn't seen this young man before, so he reached out to shake his hand and greet him, and the student said, I'd really like to talk with you one day soon. Well, they make an appointment, they have lunch a few days later, and at that time, the young man said, I've really done some bad things in my life. And Will thought, you can't imagine the number of college students that have told me that. And the young man said, no, really, I have. As a teenager, I got into drugs pretty seriously. It was all downhill from there. I would do pretty much anything to make my next score. I've even stolen from family and friends. I've done other things I'm too embarrassed to even mention now. Finally, I got caught using other people's credit card numbers, and I was put in prison. They put me in a cell with a man who could barely read, who was teaching himself to read by reading the New Testament. There's a lot of empty time in prison, so I would listen to him. I would occasionally help him read, and then in time, we would read together. And then we came to that story about the lost son and the father who welcomes him home from being far away, not just far away land, but far away in spirit. And it hit me. This was it. This was true. This was my story, and I knew that I had been dead, and now, for some reason, I was alive. When I got out of prison, I went back to school, and now I'm here. I come to chapel most every week to be with other lost and found sons and daughters. And I just wanted to tell you this because, you know, we've got Easter coming up, and you preachers are always scrounging around for stories. I just wanted to tell you that this year, I'm your Easter story. I'm the proof. Resurrection still happens. Because Jesus is alive, we share in his resurrection. Resurrection still happens. Because Jesus is alive, we want to be part of what he's doing in this world. Do you? Charles Wesley writes in the hymn we will sing, may like him we rise. Ours the cross, the graves, the skies. His death becomes our death. His resurrection becomes our resurrection. His destiny becomes our destiny. We are the Easter people. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let's pray. Lord, we desperately needed the cross, and we desperately needed the empty tomb. We've been like Mary, Peter, John, and Thomas, despairing and doubting. You've come to us with the scars to show it. You've come to us in resurrection glory. You've come to us to say, I am bringing you life. So Lord, may we never take that for granted. May we continue to come to you knowing that in you there is forgiveness. In you there is new life. Lord, we pray that for those this morning who have not experienced it. For those longing for that forgiveness, that cleansing, for those longing for that resurrection of life, that victory. Lord, may we surrender to you. May we receive what you have accomplished for us. And may we know this newness of life, not for ourselves, but so that the world may see and know and love and worship our glorious God. May it begin with us. May we rise for you. We pray this in the name of our risen Lord, the Lord of the dance, our Savior Jesus. Amen. We've been given the greatest gifts, and now we respond as we give back to the Lord through our tithes and offerings. A reminder, this is Sensibility Sunday, so loose change and designated gifts will be going to hunger efforts in our community and beyond. Let us give with joy and thanksgiving. We come to a time where we can pray for one another. There's several different ways that we can do this. There are cards in the pews, hopefully somewhere close to you, if you prefer to write down your prayer requests and put that in the offering plate after the service. Give it to me or one of the elders, and we will be honored to pray for you or someone that you are concerned for. We also have Mary in the back with one of our microphones. If you don't mind, raise your hand for concerns and celebrations. She'll bring that microphone to you so that all can hear as well. And for those who are worshiping with us virtually, if you have prayer concerns, you can put it in the comments or again, you can contact the church. So let's begin with joys and thanksgivings. We got Jason up front.
I have an obvious praise that that mom is sitting here. This has been a very long journey. The longest 4 months I've ever lived, and I know for her too. But what I wanted to say was when you watch someone get as sick as she's been, and to have so few answers and so many questions, and and I don't think she'll mind me saying this, she had bad days, and she had days of, like we all would go through. But the one thing that was consistent was her faith. And that, of course, encouraged me, because, how I could love it. She never lost her faith in all of that. And she always had that anger. And you could just tell. Even, it's funny how that works. I'm sure we've all been there. I know I have. It's like, even when you're crying out to God, and your words may even be doubt and frustration and all the stuff that we go through, it's like you could, I could still discern it in her when I would look that Jesus was there with her, and she knew it, and she was standing on that rock. So I just wanted to give that praise to God and just share that with all of you.
I just want to thank all of you for your prayers, because I know that what he said, some days laying in bed in my deepest times, and I was like, will I ever get out of bed again? Will I ever be able to go anywhere again? Will I be able to share anything again? I don't know. I can just hear God whispering in my ear. People love you. People care about you, and they're praying for you. And I appreciate that so much that I knew I had this whole team of people here pulling for me. So thank you, and I thank God that I am feeling better and that I'm it. Thank you all so much.
You even look younger than
you used to. Amen. We do pray for the Lord. We rejoice today.
I have had a cancer diagnosis. It'll be 2 years this December. And every scan since that time has been negative. Well, I go for another scan on Tuesday, so I would appreciate your prayers for me during that time. I am confident. My whole being is satisfied in Christ, so therefore I know it's going to be well. All is well. And I remember, as Kathy was saying, the prayers of people coming back to you, you could actually feel yourself being strengthened during those times, because I know of two times that I felt like I was dying, and I was just ready to just go. And the Lord would speak to me, and I would be stirred to get up. And I could feel myself getting stronger. You could feel it. And I said, somebody is praying for me. And I knew it. So don't think that your prayers just because you don't see answers sometimes that are like turning a page, they do happen. They happen discreetly, and they happen subtly, and it's still a big answer to prayer, even in the littlest things. So I see cancer patients who can't eat, and then one day, the next day, they'll get up and they'll be able to have some broth. That's an answer to prayer. That's a prayer answer. So I just want to encourage people to pray fervently for those who are sick and infirm, and pray fervently for the spiritual help in this church, because it is a blessing. It is truly a blessing. And I ask the Lord to encourage us also to be endeavoring to pray for the sick within our church and outside these walls, because there are people who are hungry and thirsting for the word of the Lord, and for whatever reason are impaired, that they can't come or they can't hear or whatever the means is. But that doesn't mean the Lord cannot touch them, because he came. And that's all it was. Just keep me in your prayers for Tuesday. I'm confident in the Lord, but I love your prayers because I'm strengthened by them.
Thank you, Robin. Becky in the back. Becky?
I agree. With Robin, the strength of prayer is alive and well in this church, and it's far-reaching. My brother Ben had a heart attack earlier this week and was in the hospital. Two major blockages in arteries. They had a stent put in. Ben is the last of the boys in our family. We all have lost our little brother several years ago, so Ben is the guy, and we are so thankful.
you know, of his quick recovery. If anybody, you all don't know him, but he's a fisherman and was out on his bass boat yesterday. So that's him. That's the way he is. Thank you all for your prayers and blessed by his quick recovery.
We give thanks. Thank you, Becky. Other joy, celebrations, thanksgivings, testimonies. I just want to thank those who gifted us with music, song, instrument. As Pam was playing Lord of the Dance, if anyone's heard St. Francis Children's Choir, I mean, that's one of their go-tos. So, you know, I always hear these children's voices in my head every time I hear that. And it's just a beautiful picture of the faith of a child and the joy that we have in Christ. We get to sing that and live it, so we rejoice in that. Others, concerns. We want to keep Randy.
This time next week, we'll be heading down to Houston, and we will be meeting with the doctor at 9:30 Central Time. Be there probably 3 days. They said probably a few business days. Now, they'll do testing. We're not sure what all that's going to be at this point, but we just pray that throughout this process that we just get good reports that that the surgeon got everything, and that it's nowhere else in the body. So. Please lift her up. Thank you.
Can you mention the date of the appointment?
Next Monday, April 22nd.
Yes.
Others? We want to continue to pray for Bill Young and Casey Strickland, both of which are saints that may very well be nearing the end of their time on this earth, but we also, they both know who they belong to. So we pray for them, pray for their family. We pray for others, for Betty O'Dell and for Ernie Powell. I think he's still trying to, they're still trying to find a rehab place for Ernie, unless someone knows, somewhere in Huntington, I think is what they're looking. And for, again, my twin brother Brian's daughter, my niece Renee, who'd been hospitalized twice, but she's released again, but she continues to have health concerns. So I appreciate the prayers there. Others. Barb.
I have a good outside voice, actually.
It's
a pretty good outside voice.
It is.
Just want to ask for prayers for Jefferson. He reached out to us yesterday. It's never good when it's like, Mom, do you have a minute to talk? Because we pray to us as Mom and Dad. That's always like the, or I need your help, Mom. And he's just struggling. So, and he's been struggling. For really ever since he was released from prison. He has just never really found his footing, I guess is the best way to say it. So I'm just, you know, part of me is so thankful for the years of, you know, the years that this church has had with open arms and that foundation, basically, that has been built with Riverlawn and the boys' farm. And if you would have told me 30-some years ago, this is what I would have found my heart in, I would have told you no. So I give thanks to Randy and to Gray and to Larry, because those times that they would come back and share the experiences and the testimony was what led me to Columbia, and from that, some wonderful blessings. And with that also some heartaches. My heart just breaks for Jefferson, that he is so lost. And so I just ask that you pray for him, that he just finds the peace, finds the help that he needs, and just continue to pray for all the boys that are at the farm and all the boys who have grown up to be men who are doing wonderful things in Columbia and men who are maybe struggling in Columbia. That we just keep those boys in our hearts.
Thank you, Laura.
Thank you.
And I imagine many, many haven't had an opportunity to learn much about Jefferson. We've known several of us have known Jefferson since he was a boy years ago. And we're more than happy to tell you, because he considers Riverlawn part of his family. And he's not able to say that about many. You know, a lot of the time he feels very alone. So we're more than happy to tell you so that you can be praying as well. And if you want to know more about this ministry, this mission, we would be honored to tell you, especially so we can be praying for our brothers and sisters and for these children. We also want to continue to pray for those who suffered in various ways over the last two storms, for the damages that people experienced, the losses people experienced, destruction and flooding. We want to be praying for those who feel the terror and fear of unrest and war and division around the world and even here at home. Those who experience that division and often what is causing that. So let us be praying for the Spirit to be working and bringing the reconciling that can only come by God. Others.
Kathy. Go ahead. Can you yell it? She's coming.
What he just said about the world we prayed for. When I was sick, we were really sick, God sent me the word broken. I don't know why, it was broken. And I realized after some time, he wanted me to pray for the world and for everybody, because it was broken. I mean, everybody's broken, everything's broken. And if we think about it, we pray for each other, we pray for everybody we love, we pray for our families. I don't know, I've now included in all of my prayers for the whole world, for the broken out there, that God will be with them, that his presence, his love, his power, everything. I know he's not going to heal them all. I know he's not going to give them all food. I know that they're not going to all be spared abuse. But his presence with them is so powerful. And I think that was why he gave me that word. And it was just broken. And I just urge everyone here, when you say those prayers and you say it night or day or whatever you do your devotions, that you remember to add everybody into that. I mean, just everybody into that. So that we all become one big community of faith and believers in our Lord, instead of starting a little collection. But I still appreciate all your prayers. So yes, thank you. Okay.
Thank you, Kathy. And those who've experienced brokenness and those who are called to minister to the broken, let's begin that as we pray together. Let's pray. Lord, we come before you and we do give you the praise. We thank you that even in the midst of need and brokenness, pain, loss, grief, fear, doubts, you remain unchanging. You remain ever faithful and ever loving and all powerful. And when you've conquered death, it proved it. May we rest, not only in the truth, but the power of that for us even today. And so we lift up those who are hurting, who are struggling, who could very much be blessed by your presence, your assurance, your spirit, the comforter. Lord, we pray for Jefferson. Lord, we pray for Bill Young and Casey Stripling, Betty O'Dell, Bernie Powell, Renee. Lord, we pray for those who are going to be receiving tests, those who are waiting upon you. Lord, we pray for Robin for this Tuesday. We pray for Caroline that following Monday. Lord, we pray for Ben. Thank you that you sustain his life and that he's even able to do the things he enjoys and loves, and we give you thanks for that. Lord, we thank you for the testimony and your sustaining power in Kathy's life. We pray that you continue to bring her healing to pass and strengthen her body as she relies upon you. Lord, we pray for those who experience damage and devastation and loss through the storms and the flooding recently and throughout West Virginia and other surrounding states. Those who have faced other forms of devastation and disaster that often we do not even give much thought or attention to, but you do. Lord, where there is division and hatred and violence and deception and pride, Lord, we pray that you will enter in to redeem and restore. Show us how we can be a part of it, that we can bring hope, your healing, your touch, your provision where there is need. And we thank you that we're able to because Jesus is risen, and like him we rise. And so we pray these things in the name of our risen Lord Jesus, the one who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Church, let us sing and believe. Christ the Lord is risen today. Verses 1 and 4. Please stand.
Thank you.
want to invite you to a time of fellowship following worship in the gym. That I believe the deacons will be meeting after that fellowship. If you have a need of prayer, if you have questions, if you just want to talk to someone, if you want to know more about Christ being the first fruits of our own resurrection, we'd be overjoyed to just linger with that and celebrate who he is. And now we want to leave this place with this benediction from 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 17. Now to the King, eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor, glory, forever and ever. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus, the love of God the Father, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now as he sends you and as you live the resurrected life for his glory. Amen.